Good morning and God bless you. I'm so happy to be here on Youth Sunday, excited to lift high the name of Jesus. I want to invite all of our special guests to participate with us today. If you're here, you're part of our online congregation where we lift high the name of Jesus. But first, let's pray. Father God in heaven, thank you so much for this day that you've made. Thank you for the blessing of your honor, the protection that you're giving us, the privilege of allowing us to be gathered in your name, Lord. Be glorified in all that we do. Thank you so much for gathering us together. Thank you so much for the time of prayer, praise, and worship that will ensue. Lord God, you be glorified in all that we do as we lift high your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, everybody, let's get ready for praise and worship, and I'll be back right after that. God bless.
Join in worship. Let us praise the Lord together. Hallelujah. Jehovah is your name. Thank you, Lord. Jehovah is your name. Hallelujah. Jehovah is your name. Jehovah is your name.
Holy. is led. Right now we stand calling you healer. And healer you are. Healer you be. Yeah. I call you all that. Yeah.
I call you all that.
Your name is all that. You have been all that.
Great is our God. Hey. times you have to speak victory during the test, and no matter how you feel, speak the word over your life and you will be healed. Speak over yourself, encourage yourself in the Lord. Oh, 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 oh. Sometimes you, hallelujah, you have to pat your own self on the back, yeah, yeah, yeah. Have to speak victory during the test. And no matter how you feel,
you
speak the word over your life. Oh, oh.
You will be healed. Speak over yourself.
Encourage yourself. Pressure is all around, but God is present help. Oh, the enemy created walls, but remember giants, they do fall. Speak over yourself, encourage yourself. Oh,
Amen. What a great time of praise and worship. We've set the atmosphere. We're excited to come into the presence of our great God to bring our prayer request. I want to encourage you to bring everything to Him. There's nothing too big for God. Big or small, He can handle it all. Remember the names on the prayer list. Make sure you lift those up. God bless you, and we'll come back in just a minute. Come on, let's go now to prayer. Well, it's Youth Sunday. We're excited to be able to have our youth pastor, Pastor Dari, come on and share a word of encouragement for the young folk. Pray for him, and let's receive the anointed word of God. Pastor Dari?
Good morning, everybody. We will get started with a quick word of prayer, then get right into the word. Father God, we just thank you. We thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you for another opportunity to worship you, to praise you, to lift you up. We are so grateful and thankful for who you are, for what you've done for us, Father God. We just give you all the praise and the glory, Father. We ask that your word will go forth, that it will go forth boldly, that it will change hearts and minds, Father God. I ask that you just speak through me, Father God, and have your people hear what you would have to say. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So our scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 136, the first verse. And I'm reading from the New King James Version. The word of the Lord says, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. You know, thankfulness is a funny thing. You know, people usually need something tangible to be thankful for. Usually it's something personal that deeply or greatly affects them. You're thankful when you get stuff. For example, you get a day off that you weren't expecting, or you get a PlayStation 5. Hint, hint, Jennifer. But that feeling of thankfulness is usually something that's transactional. There's a reason why we are thankful. And of course, we're approaching Thanksgiving Day, and in the next few weeks, we're going to be buying turkeys. We're going to be getting prepared for it. And the words thanks and thankful are going to be on the forefront of many people's minds and their lips. There will be many a family that sits around the table making each other say what they were thankful for this year while the turkey gets cold and the stuffing gets hard. And it's traditional to do this to show that we are what we're tangibly thankful for throughout the year, even if it's something that seems small or benign. However, this year, many people might struggle with thinking about what they are thankful for. It's easy to be thankful when things are going well, when we have a new car or a new house, or life is going the way that we expect it or the way that we hope for. But what happens when life becomes unexpected? What happens when life doesn't go the way that we hope, when things aren't going the way that we want it to? How are we thankful then? And if there's a word that describes the year 2020, it is unexpected. So in the face of a global pandemic, social unrest, and financial uncertainty, how in a few weeks are we going to be able to sit around the table with our families, presumably with less family members than usual because of the restrictions, and say what we're thankful for? How do we engender that feeling of thankfulness, a real positive thankfulness, not just a relief feel thankfulness, saying that, oh, I'm glad that it wasn't me. I'm glad it hasn't affected me the way it might have affected other people. But a happy, joyful feeling of thankfulness when our Thanksgiving dinner rolls around in a few weeks. See, for Christians and for believers, that answer is simple. The answer is we can be thankful because of God. And that might seem a bit too simple, a bit too simplistic. To some people, it might even feel dismissive. I know for a lot of people that I know that are skeptics when it comes to believing in God or believing in Jesus Christ, the idea of just saying, do this because of God, be thankful because of God, be joyous because of God, it feels like a cop-out for them. There's nothing tangible that they can hold on to for that. There's nothing, no evidence that shows why they should be happy, why they should be thankful. A lot of times when you just say, I'm thankful because of God, or I am this because of God, they think that you're just an ostrich sticking your head in the sand, avoiding what the problems are, especially in times when they're difficult, in times that are difficult. What they do not realize is that it takes a lot of courage and a lot of faithfulness to stand thankful in God because of who he is, because of what he's done, despite what the scenario is in your life. Even if it's negative or positive, your thankfulness doesn't change. Because God is not always just something that's tangible. Of course, there's tangible things about God. There's blessings. There's the times where we see his life, he see his work in our life. But a lot of times, God lives in the intangibles. It's those feelings of joy, that feeling of peace despite your situation, that intangible reason why you can be happy and joyous even though things aren't going the way you expect it. That's where God steps in, and we see him, this intangibles of the Holy Spirit and of God in our everyday lives. See, Psalm 136, specifically the first verse, encapsulates the feeling of thankfulness one should feel for God and why we should be thankful for God. And we can imply infer that what the writer is saying, that we should be thankful at all times for God. See, interestingly, the author of this psalm is not known. So we don't know why they're thankful. We don't know what spurred on them writing this psalm. And I think that's really poetic when you think about it, because we shouldn't always have to have a reason, something that God did for us to be thankful. We need to be thankful for God because he is God. And knowing that helps to engender that feeling. And we see that in that scripture, that he is, this writer is just thankful. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Psalm 136 is also known as the great Hallel, or the great praise. And that is something that is quite apropos to this scripture as well, because it is praise. You can see, you can feel the praise as you read it. Somebody is praising God and they are thankful because of God. When we're thankful, there should be a great praise in that thankfulness, an excitement. We should be joyous. And when we see the opening sentence in this scripture, there's an exclamation point at the end. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. We are exclaiming, we are happy, we are joyful. And it's not just that thank you that you say when somebody forces you to say thank you, like when you get a gift from somebody, from that auntie that you don't really like that sweater, and your mom makes you say thank you anyway. That's not how we say thank you to God. We say thank you to God with excitement, with reverence, with praise. So let's look at this scripture so that we can learn not to have a resigned thankfulness as we approach Thanksgiving Day, but a thankfulness that is joyous, a thankfulness that is filled with praise for our God. The first part of the scripture we see is give thanks to the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. That is simple enough. But there are so many things and so many people that we can be thankful for or thankful to. And a lot of times we can allow those things to overwhelm us and not always give the full thanks to God that he deserves just for being God. All the things that our life offers us can sometimes shroud the thankfulness that we're supposed to be giving to God at all times. A lot of times, we thank God in a, well, it's the least that you could do way. We expect God to do things for us. But God does things for us without having to. He does it from the kindness of his heart because he loves us. So we need to have that understanding whenever we give thanks, that we first give thanks to God in everything that we do. We give thanks unto the Lord. See, our thankfulness needs to be thoughtfully presented. In the ancient Hebrew, the phrase give thanks was presented as something that was cast down, like casting down a sacrifice upon the feet of the Lord. Our thanks should be like a sacrifice, something that's thought out, something that is given because that person righteously deserves it. You know, our thankfulness is not just something about us saying thank you, or even just giving that thanks to God, but our thankfulness is a witness to God, to others who see that we are thankful to God despite our circumstances. So now we are bearing witness of God's goodness. We are bearing witness of God's grace because we can be thankful even if things aren't going the way we expect it. See, our thanks is not just about our gratitude, although there is gratitude involved because we need to be grateful for the things that God has done. But it is a message to others that God is real and God is there. The ancient Hebrew used the word Yahweh when referring to God in this scripture, which means the one true God. And because he is the one true God, he deserves our fervent and purest thanks. He deserves the thanks that comes from the bottom of our soul that we have pushed out because we understand two things. First, who he is. And we see this in the second part of the first verse where he says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. We should be thankful to God for who he is. And there are so many times There's so many times when I'm thankful for people just because of who they are, not necessarily for what they're done. There's so many situations with my wife where she knows how to make me laugh when I'm not feeling great, or she knows how to make me feel better when I'm not feeling great. And even though that she's doing something for me in those moments, I'm thankful that she was built in a way that complements me, because I've seen the other side of it in previous relationships, friendships or otherwise, where they don't really complement you. They're not really built to help you deal with things the way that you need to deal with them. So I'm thankful for that. Thankful for who she is, how she was made. And that's the same thankfulness that we should have for God. We need to be thankful for who he is. Not always just thankful for what he's done. Because when we say God is, we can fill that in with a bunch of different positive attributes. God is great. God is merciful. God is powerful. The writer used "for he is good." And the good here expresses morality. That means he is moral. When somebody is moral, that means that you know that despite the situation, they're going to have integrity. So even if things are going bad or even if things are going well, they're going to have integrity and they're going to have your best interest at heart. And that's why we need to be thankful for God. For he is good. For he is moral. For he is going to have our best interest despite our situations, despite our circumstances. That no matter what happens in our life, we can always trust in the goodness of God. But also, we can trust in what he is doing. For his mercy endures forever. So as I was talking before, we don't always need to be thankful for what God has done. So I want to say we should still be thankful for the stuff he does for us. But that shouldn't be the only time we're thankful and happy and joyful, is that when he does stuff for us. We need to be thankful for who he is and for what he has done. See, God does so much for us that there's so much that we can be thankful for. But what the author focuses on here is God's mercy. And he talks about how that mercy endures. The dictionary definition of both words are very interesting. Mercy is showing compassion or forgiveness towards someone from someone who has the power to punish them. So a judge having mercy on somebody, they can put you in jail, but they decide to pardon you. That is showing mercy. And endures means to suffer something painful or difficult patiently. Let's think about all the times we've tested God's patience, and yet that mercy, that ability to forgive us, even though we don't ever deserve it, is still there. It still endures. It endures those tests. It endures those times when we try his patience. His mercy endures forever, for all time. It's not going to go away. And that's something that we should be thankful for, because he is actually actively doing something for us in those moments. He is actively showing mercy to us. He's actively showing patience towards us. And that is the ultimate thing that encompasses everything, because that mercy allows him to bless us. That mercy allows him to guide us. That mercy allows him to comfort us. So we should be thankful and experience the love and mercy of God and show him that thankfulness at all times for what he has done and for who he is. So this Thanksgiving, give thanks to God despite any circumstances. Because as we can see, because of who he is and because of what he's done, because he is Yahweh, the one true God, he righteously deserves it. And he has our best interests at heart. May God add a blessing to his word. We thank you so much, Father God, for your word. We thank you so much for your mercy, for your grace, Father God. We thank you for who you are, because you are the one true God. So we give you the praise, and in this Thanksgiving time, we're just so thankful for you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God bless everybody.
Thank you, Pastor Dari, for that inspiring word of God. Now it's time to worship the Lord through giving. Come on and give God some praise today. You know it's an exciting time to be able to recognize what God has done for us. This is what we're going to do today. We're going to pray first, and then I'll instruct you so everyone can participate. Father God, thank you so much for this day you've made. Thank you for your presence, your people, for prayer, praise, and worship. Now as we come to the time of worship through giving, God, we want you to be glorified. We want to put our focus on you, thanking you for the things that you've done for us, Lord, how you've blessed the ministry, how you've taken care of us through these difficult times. I'm aware, Lord God, that under the sound of my voice, there may be those who are suffering, those who are struggling financially. Lord, open up doors of opportunity for them that they may be able to give the way their hearts desire. Thank you, Lord God, that you do all things well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, now there's a couple different ways for you to give. We have electronic giving, and you'll see those on the screen. PayPal, Venmo, Zelle, and Cash App. These are the ways that we use electronic giving, and they're very convenient. You can also send your check to SCCF Church, mailing it to our P.O. Box 800215, Santa Clarita, California, 91380. Want to invite everybody to be a part of that. Come on, let's give right now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hi, this is Pastor Winston. I'm inviting you to join us in our Wednesday night Bible study. Our Wednesday night Bible study beginning November 11th, that's going to take us to the end of the year, is a series we're calling One Another. During these times, we need one another. We're going to have to lean on one another. So I invite you. We're going to learn how we can love one another, serve one another, exhort one another, encourage one another. So I'm inviting you. Our Wednesday night Bible study begins at 7:30 on YouTube and Facebook. But if you can't catch us on Wednesday, anytime it's still available there. Our studies are less than an hour. I'm trying to respect your time because I want you to grow in God's Word. So a Bible study, looking forward to seeing you Wednesday at 7:30. God bless you. Thank you for joining us.
Holidays, we're getting ready for the Christmas season, and I just want to encourage you and invite you to join us in granting Christmas wishes to children in foster care by donating $50 to sponsor a child. Funds will be used to purchase gifts, which will be presented to the children on Christmas Eve. Please make your check payable to Santa Clarita Christian Fellowship and mail it to Box 800215, Santa Clarita, California. Donations can also be made via Zelle, Venmo, Cash App, or PayPal. This is one of a number of different promotions that we'll be doing. Lift high the name of Jesus and show the love of Christ during this holiday season. You may say, yeah, Pastor Harper, I'm doing all kinds of things. Well, congratulations this holiday season, because to whom much is given, much is required. And God is calling us to join in, lift high his name, and to minister to the people in our community. God bless you. Looking forward to having a tremendously successful event in granting Christmas wishes to foster care children. Have a great day. God bless. Now it's time for the Word of God. Pastor Winston will be bringing the Word today. Pray for him and pray with him as we receive God's anointed Word. God bless you.
Well, praise God for this another opportunity to share his Word with you. I invite you to open your Bibles to the Book of Joel, chapter 2. Joel is one of the minor prophets. If you found Daniel, Hosea, Joel. Joel, chapter 2. Before we get into the Word, let's bow. God, our Father, how we thank you for this day that you have made. Lord, thank you for this another Sunday that we could declare your Word here in service. Lord, we pray that you would be in our midst, even though we're not gathered in a corporate body in person. Lord, we thank you that you are right where we are. Lord, thank you that you speak to us. You speak through us. Lord, we're better for having worshiped you today and heard your Word today. So we commit this time to you, O God. Thank you for doing what only you can do. In Jesus' name, amen. Joel chapter 2. There are two short verses that I have on the screen. It's from the New King James Version. And I know you're there in your home, but if you can, with a good strong voice, let's read it all together. Let's go. And it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. And also on my men servants and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. Amen. This is the word of our God. Amen. Our message is entitled very simply, A Vision for Your Future. A Vision for Your Future. If I were to ask you 5 years ago where you would see yourself in life today, I am sure most of you would have given a different response. Some may have thought you would have been in college and are outside of your parents' home. Some would have talked about a job they were expecting or a promotion they were to achieve. You may not have seen the blessings of God that he gave you to get to you where you are today. Fast forward to November of 2020 and reflect on what your 5 year ago self thought. And you will see what kind of vision that you had. And I can guarantee you almost 100% it was not the 2020 that we are experiencing right now. But despite not seeing yourself where you are today, living with a global pandemic, having restrictions on your movement and gathering, staying at home to work, wearing a mask when you go out, how many of you know that we are blessed? Every sermon in this year's series, we've asked this question. And even as I reflect on this question, I can see that my responses have changed since January. What was the question? What is your vision for your life in 2020? In what, about 40, 41 days, we'll close the books on this year. Back in January, when we asked this question, where are you seeing yourself and what are you doing? Being at home so much and restricted from certain activities has given us the opportunity to think and reflect on our lives. And we are living in a time when some people are scared about the future, while some embrace it with expectation. We're looking to God to do something unique and exciting, while others want to turn back the clock to a time of a bygone era that, quite frankly, it ain't gonna ever return. As we focus on our text this morning in Joel 2, there is a phrase that brings out our text into clearer focus, and it's called very simply, the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is a clear concept in Scripture, especially from the Old Testament prophetic books. The day of the Lord is not an isolated phenomenon or a single event in human history, but it's a time when God is showing the world who he is and why are we brought into account with him. The day of the Lord is not just a day of God's wrath and judgment, but it also includes deliverance and restoration for the righteous people of God. It's amazing. God can bring wrath and judgment on one group, while at the same time being blessing and hope and prosperity on another. And you get to decide what group you're going to be in. When we are right with God, we want the day of the Lord. We long for him to show his strength, because we know that we abide in him. But when we are not right with God, We dread the day of the Lord. Because when God shows himself strong, his strength may work against us. But let's focus on Joel 2. I had you turn there in your Bibles. A couple scriptures we're going to have on the screen, but I want you to keep your Bible open. Look at Joel 2 for a moment. Look at verse 1 and 2. Joel starts off that chapter by saying, blow the trumpet in Zion and sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. For it is his hand, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness, like the morning clouds spread over the mountains. A people come, great and strong, the like of whom has never been, nor will there ever be such after them, even for many successive generations. We can be assured that when God says something's coming, it's coming. It's a day, Joel says, of darkness and gloominess. The world will not be singing the joyful songs on this day. It's a time when people need to turn their attention to God. But skip down to verse 12 of Joel 2. It's on the screen there. It says, now therefore, says the Lord, turn to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. So rend your heart and not your garment. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and he relents from doing harm. Who knows if he will turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. The prophet Joel gives the Old Testament means of repentance, fasting, weeping, and mourning. And he says they were to rend their hearts and not your garments because they heard the warning of judgment. God's people need to repent. We need to repent when we hear it. When you show signs of sorrow in that day, you would tear your clothes and you would wail and lament and, oh God, oh, you would have an outward expression that you were sorrowful. But in this case, Joel is calling people not to rend your clothes, but rend your heart. Why? Because he says at the end of verse 14, for he, meaning God, he's gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and he relents from doing harm. Some people see God as just a mean person that can't wait to get you. But no, it's a, listen, God, you are gracious. You are merciful. You have kindness in you. But there are steps that can be taken to secure our position with God. When we get our attitude and our actions right, there's a blessing that's in store for us. Notice what it says in verse 23 to 25. This is on the screen, but I know your Bible is still open. He says, be glad then, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the former rain faithfully, and he will cause the rain to come down for you, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. The threshing floor shall be full of wheat, and that shall overflow with new wine and oil. So I will restore to you the years that the swarming locusts have eaten. You think about it. These many years ago, ancient Israel had no irrigation system and relied on rain to water the crops. In a time of drought, nothing grew. But God promises to restore both the former rain, those rains falling in the autumn months, and the latter rain, those that fall in the springtime. When God restores the rains, Judah will have a full threshing floors of and wine baths. They're going to have an abundant crop. It's a promise of restoration. All of us want the blessing, but we need to put ourselves in a position to receive the blessing. The day of the Lord, it's coming. But will you look for it expectantly or with dread? Because the central question is, ready? How will you position yourself to look expectantly for the coming day of the Lord? How will you position yourself to look for this? See, you must put yourself in a position to receive from God. There is an after effect of getting lined up with God. What Joel spoke about at the beginning of the chapter. See, if someone said they wanted to bless you and give you, say, for instance, an all-expense-paid trip to Hawaii, all you had to do was pack your bags and be at LAX airport on a particular day. If you said, I prefer to fly out of Burbank because it's less crowded, guess what's going to happen? You going to miss the flight because the ticket was from LAX to Honolulu, not from Burbank. Why? You didn't position yourself to be in a position to get the blessing. So how can you do that? Three simple things, and we'll be through. The first one is, ready? You have to embrace the promise. Look what it says in Joel 2, the A portion of verse 28 and the B portion of verse 29. It says, and it shall come to pass afterwards that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Verse 29, the B portion says, I will pour out my spirit in those days. When you do what you're supposed to do, God goes to work. But receiving from God is never passive. It's always active. When you have done what you need to do, God says that he would pour out his spirit on all flesh. In the minds of the people in Joel's day, this was a radical departure. Not everyone had the Spirit of God. It was limited to certain men at a certain time for certain duties. And quite frankly, it was rather selective. Scripture says in Genesis 41, that Joseph was filled with the Spirit of God to lead Egypt through the time of bounty and famine. The craftsmen who built the tabernacle were filled with the Spirit of God. Joshua, it says, was filled with the Spirit of God. Gideon was filled with the Spirit of God to deliver the Israelites, it says in Judges 6. David was filled with the Spirit of God when Samuel anointed him king over Israel in 1 Samuel 16. But other people, you don't see that. And in the Hebrew, the word spirit, it's the Hebrew word ruach. And sometimes it's translated breath or wind. When you embrace the promise of God, you have it close to you. And you can receive from it. God is giving it to you for a purpose. Notice what Jesus said in John 7, verse 37 and 38. It says, on the last day of the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. And then the Apostle John gives his commentary. In verse 39, he says, but this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. But receiving the Spirit is just a fulfillment of what God promised. Notice from Isaiah 44 verse 3, and this is from the New Living Translation. It says, "For I will pour out water to quench your thirst and to irrigate your parched fields." And he says, "And I will pour out my Spirit on your descendants and my blessing on your children." See, everybody could not receive the Spirit. Jesus gave his disciples the most extensive understanding of the Holy Spirit in the upper room in John 14, verse 16 and 17. Notice what Jesus says to them. He says, "And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever." And Jesus says in verse 17, "It's the Spirit of truth whom the world can't receive." I'm glad the world can't get what we got, because Jesus says it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. He dwells with you, but will be in you. The Holy Spirit is not going to have its most effective work in you until it's in you. Let me explain it with an example that we're going through right now. We're living in a time of COVID-19. And what is that? It is an airborne virus. We get it if we are in close contact with someone who has it and they breathe on us. Those microscopic air particles are tiny droplets of water that contain the coronavirus. We wear a mask and remain 6 feet from people because we're trying to protect ourselves from getting corona. As long as the mask is on and I keep my distance, I'm pretty well safe and secure. How does this relate to Joel 2 and embracing the promise? In this case, we want the breath of God. We want him to breathe on us and pour out his Spirit on us. However, my sin, my transgression, my disobedience, my hard heart, my funky attitude, my stubbornness, it's like keeping the mask over my face so that God can't breathe on me. When I take the mask off, I allow him to infect my life. And this infection is not going to cause me harm, but it's going to bless me. So what do we need to do? What do we need to do? We need to embrace the promise. Secondly, what do we need to do? We need to entertain the proclamation. Notice he says in the B portion of verse 28, "Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy." See, this phrase, "your sons and your daughters shall prophesy," it doesn't grasp our attention in 2020. But in Joel's day, it was radical. Because women didn't have a speaking role in the ecclesiastical life of the community. Joel is saying here, God is ushering in a new age in his relationship to man and in their relationship with one another. The Apostle Paul says in Galatians, that there will be no longer Jew or Greek, bond or free, male or female, because you're all one in Christ. See, he's ushering in a new relationship, but the problem is we don't see it because we can't or we don't want to entertain something new. Let's tell the truth. This is how sometimes we see ourselves. I can't do it. I'm not good enough. Nobody loves me. Why would God choose me? I think he should use so-and-so. They're a whole lot more qualified than I am. And when you look over at so-and-so, they're saying, oh, I think he should use so-and-so because they're much more qualified than I am. How many of you have written a rejection letter before you ever applied for the job? My first job in the law firm that I worked for, the only reason I applied because there was a misspelling in the ad in the Daily Journal newspaper, and I said, it can't be all that good a law firm because they spelt filing wrong. And I said, well, I'm going to apply. They ain't that smart. And I made the mistake of pulling the Martindale Hubble. It was a legal directory, and it showed all the people on the firm. And I said, well, let me look them up, just make sure. And when I'm looking through, I looked at the firm. I didn't know it was one of the top law firms and still is in Los Angeles. It's the firm that had more Supreme Court clerks than anybody. All those folks are law review and top of their class. And I said, well, I'm going for interview experience. And I went into the interview and I sat down and I. I said, I ain't getting this job. I left and I said, it's interview experience. And I'm thankful for that. Only to get a call offering me the job. I had written a rejection letter the day before I went to the interview. See, our self-esteem sometimes can be so low that we think we can play handball against the curb. But what was Joel saying when he said, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy? Here it is, ready? He says, you will be empowered to do something either you have never done before or thought you could never do. I'm going to say it again. You will be empowered to do something either you have never done before or thought you could never do. Before Jesus went into heaven in Acts 1, he told his followers in Acts 1:8, he said, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. They were instructed where to go and wait. Over 500 people received his instruction, but only 120 obeyed the instruction. And in Acts 2, we know the story. It says in verse 2 of Acts 2, it says, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. That's that ruach. That's that breath of God. It's the wind that came in, and it says, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared unto them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat on each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So many like to focus on the tongues, but they totally miss the implications of this event. The proclamation from this verse is that you were going to be empowered to do something you had never done before. Because to prophesy, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. No, to prophesy is not for you, but for someone else. Pick up what's going on. Turn to your Bibles in Acts 2. This is from the New Living translation. And it says, they were completely amazed. How can this be? These are the people hearing them. How can this be? These people are all from Galilee. And yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages. Here we are, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, the province of Galatia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the areas of Libya around Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, and we all hear these people speaking in our own languages about the wonderful things God has done. They stood there amazed and perplexed and said, what can this mean? They asked one another. We all hear these people speaking in our own languages about the wonderful things God has done. What did God do? His Spirit came, and the Holy Spirit enabled them to speak not just some babbling, but speak in a language they had never known before, which was never taught to them, to tell somebody else about the wonderful things that God has done. Who was in the room? Men and women. Who was speaking? Men and women. The Apostle Peter had to put it in proper context. He says in Acts 2, verse 14, he says, but Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judah and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let it be known to you and heed my words. For these are not drunk, because that's what folks said. Oh, it's 9 o'clock in the morning, and they then got lit at 9 o'clock, and they just tow up, and that's all it is. But Peter said, no, these are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. It's only 9 a.m. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And here's my admonition for you today. Ready? Break the chain that's holding you back. Break the chain that's holding you back. What is God speaking into your heart that you have said no to? In my own personal life, when I was in high school, and I thought I wanted to be a lawyer. One of my favorite TV shows, and still is Perry Mason. When I finished college, I knew that law school, being a lawyer, wasn't in the cards, but I said I really kind of wanted to teach on the college level. I felt the call of God in the ministry, but I thought that was something I really did not want to do. That was a lot of responsibility. That was a lot of work. So I made a compromise with God. And I enrolled in seminary with the expectation of teaching on the college level when I got through. But I wasn't planning on being a preacher. My compromise was, I'll help other ministers, but I'm not going to do that. I was a Christian. I knew God. I was born again. But I wanted to be a normal Christian, not one of them preacher Christians. But I could not see what God could do and would do in my life until I broke the chain that was holding me back. Flash forward 30 years, and I realized something. When you surrender to God, you don't lose, you win. I wanted to be a lawyer. But for the last 35 years, I have worked with them. And see more clearly every day. That job wasn't for me. But I'm still involved in that field. I wanted to teach at the college level. But God has so fixed it that I'm an instructor at my job's training facility that I train people all over the United States. I did not see myself in pulpit Christian ministry, but for almost 25 years, I've been doing it because I had to entertain the proclamation. I know the vision for your life, for your future. It may be scary. But look what God told Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1 when he tried to give God an excuse. He said, God says, this is Jeremiah writes, this is what God said. Before I shape you in the womb, I knew all about you. Before you saw the light of day, I had holy plans for you. A prophet to the nations. That's what I had in mind for you. But I said, Jeremiah said, hold it, master. Look at me. I don't know anything, and I'm only a boy. I'm young. But God told me, don't say I'm only a boy. I'll tell you where to go, and you'll go there. I'll tell you what to say, and you'll say it. Don't be afraid of a soul. I'll be right there looking after you. God has a greater plan when you embrace, when you entertain that proclamation. But third thing is, ready? Expand your potential. Look what it says in verse 28C portion. It says, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. Just in this one simple verse, Joel 2:28, we see that we need to embrace the promise. Be open to the breath of God pouring into you. You need to entertain the proclamation that you will be empowered to do something you have never done before or thought you could ever do. But finally, you need to expand your potential. Joel says, your old men shall dream dreams. I'm glad he didn't put an age on old men. And your young men shall see visions. Visions and dreams are audiovisual means of communication between a heavenly being and an earthly recipient. It's important to note that the difference between a vision and a dream is that a vision is given when a person is awake, while a dream is given to a person who's asleep. But both of them are audiovisual means of communication. When dreams are mentioned in the Bible, they are almost always prophetic in nature. And when they are fulfilled at a later time, they are validated as having their source from God. Think about those in Scripture that experienced visions and dreams. God used a vision in Genesis 15:1 to Abraham to reinstate the Abrahamic covenant and tell him that he was going to have a son. Jacob in Genesis 28:12 had a dream of a ladder was set up on the earth and it reached to the top of heaven, and there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. Daniel in Daniel 7:3 had a vision of the coming Messiah when he says, I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man coming with clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before me. In Luke 1, God used a vision to tell Zacharias, an old priest, that he would soon have an important son. And not long afterwards, Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth gave birth to John the Baptist. God never gives us, stay with me now, God never gives us
visions and dreams for us to say, oh, that was very nice. No, he uses them to communicate a truth and to foretell what he's going to do. You get a picture of what God can do and what he will accomplish. In these last days, in this day of the Lord, he wants to plant a vision and a dream on your heart. And we need to make sure we don't run away from it. Just because you are older doesn't mean that you can't dream any longer. Your age, whether you're 5, 15, 35, 75, or 85, your age has nothing to do with the vision God can place in you. He may give you a vision and a dream, but it's not for you to accomplish in your own strength. Because if you could do it by yourself, it's not much of a vision. Those visions and dreams are to help you to see beyond your current circumstances and abilities. The Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians 3:20, now to him who's able to do like this, exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or even think. But how is that accomplished? According to the power that works in us. That power that raised Jesus from the dead on the third day. That power that filled those 120 in the upper room that turned this whole world upside down. That power that could change a life and heart and make you a person that people can see that it was nobody but God that did it in your life. When you expand your potential, you'll see it's not you, but the Christ that's in you. The minute you say, I can't see myself doing fill in the blank, I can't see myself doing that, it's time for you to stop and remember what Paul told the Corinthian church in 2 Corinthians 9:8. He says, and I love it from the Contemporary English Version, he says, God can bless you with everything you need, and you will always have more than enough to do all kinds of good things for others. God's blessings are not for you to hoard. No, God's blessings for you are to share with somebody else. See, our God is a God of miracles, signs, and wonders. And I'm going to leave you with this one message. Ready? Don't stop dreaming or stifling your vision for what can happen. Don't put the lid on possibilities that can happen in your life. Because what can you do when you catch a vision of what God will do in your life? He will empower you to do great things that you have never known before. Your future will be greater than your past. You may say, I messed up. Oh, look what I did. And God says, I can wipe it clean. All things are possible to him who believes. Keep believing. We know that our God is awesome. As a songwriter says, he can move mountains, keep you in your valley, and hide you from the rain. God will do more for you than you've ever realized when you expand your potential. And the best thing I could say for you today is, keep dreaming. keep a vision. Yeah, it may have shifted this year. It didn't turn out how you want it to. But God is able to make all grace abound towards you. That you'll be blessed with everything you need. And you'll still be able to share. I just want to speak to you just for one moment. Because you may be here today. You may be watching. You may be listening. And you don't have a relationship with Jesus. See, you'll be in that category that when we talk about the day of the Lord, you'll be scared because you say, ooh, I don't want to do that. It would be like if you were in school and the instructor says, oh, we're having a pop quiz, and you know that you didn't read the chapter. You know you didn't study. You know you didn't prepare. So you know that you might as well just get up and walk out the room because you know you got an F. See, none of us know when we'll go into eternity. None of us know that day or the hour that Jesus may return. It's a mystery. But Scripture says today, if you will hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Don't say, well, I'll get myself. No, you won't get yourself nowhere. God accepts you just as you are. Years ago, a songwriter said, just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. And with that, you bid me come to you. Oh, Lamb of God, you know what? I'm coming. So if that's you, you don't have a relationship with Jesus. I want you to just pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I'm inviting you into my heart. I'm giving you all of me. Come into my life. Save me. Make me a new creation in Christ Jesus. I love you. I'll serve you. I'll obey you all the days of my life. My friend, if that's your prayer, God hears you. There's a number on the screen there. You could call us, text us. We'd like to send you some literature, get you plugged in, even though we're physically distant from one another. We want to make sure you get plugged in to the body of Christ. You don't need to be out there alone by yourself. And if you step back from God, you know what? God allows U-turns, that same number. Say, God, I'm coming home. I'm coming back. Get into a relationship and watch what he can do. God bless you. God keep you.
Amen, and thank you, Pastor Winston, for that word. So good to be together today, sharing, praying, growing in the things of God. We've come to the conclusion of today's service, and I want to thank each and every one of you for being with us. Special thanks to our guest today for joining us. I want to encourage you to come on back and be together with us online or in person when that time happens. We also want to encourage you, our regular viewers and our regular members, regarding the various activities that are taking place as we approach this holiday season and 4Q in general. Keep your eyes open and your heart open for the foster care promotion where you can support a child. Details of that were announced during the announcement portion. Also want to encourage you to join us, ladies, online for Girlfriend's Guide to God. The details are right there. You can look at those on the screen. Then on Wednesday at 7:30, our Bible study is available to all who would tie in. It's a great Bible study, and we want to encourage you to do that. Keep on praying for our country, for our state, our nation, and our city. as we continue to pray for each other, let's continue to believe that God is able to do abundantly beyond all that we might think or ask. Now, it's time to dismiss and let's pray. Father God, thank you so much that you've taken great care of us. Lord God, you've put things together in a tremendous way. We know that we can trust and lean and depend on you. Regardless of what goes on in this country, in this world, you are in control. So, Lord God, we want to ask and thank you in advance for your peace that surpasses all understanding. Keep us and guard us as we go on about our path, tasks and duties. Hold us close to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now with your hands raised, repeat after me. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide henceforth, now, and forevermore. And all of the people of God said, amen. Have a great week. We look forward to seeing you, connecting with you again next week. Have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.